No, Lance, I went Amarillo just for you. You know, I was telling Lance when he asked me to read the scripture, this is just not part of this sermon, but the scripture I'm getting ready to read out of 1 Corinthians 13. 1 Corinthians 13, I had to learn in the sixth grade. It was part of the instruction from the teacher. This is back in 1968. Martin Luther King was just assassinated. And it was her way, because it was trying times, there was turmoil, there were animosities being formed in an integrated environment. And her background, she wanted us to learn this, to try as her way of healing at the time. So I'll be reading from 1 Corinthians 13, starting in verse 4. Love is patient. Love is kind. It does not envy. It does not boast. It is not proud. It is not rude. It is not self-seeking. It is not easily angered. It keeps no records of wrong. Love does not delight in evil, but rejoices with the truth. It always protects. It always trusts. It always hopes. It always perseveres. Love never fails.
Thank you, Carl. Tonight we're actually going to be looking at that verse more specifically, and I think what you just said about your teacher and the times in which he had memorized that, very appropriate. Title of this morning's lesson is The Message of Marriage, and this is not a message about marriage necessarily, but it's what does our marriage speak? Because our messages, or our marriages, actually do give a message. They do teach something, and that's what we're going to kind of look at this morning. I appreciate Greg's prayer this morning. I appreciate Mark's comments on the Lord's Supper table. We are talking a lot about marriage this month, because I think it's just so important for us as Christians to understand what our marriages mean in society today. And we've had a couple of different marriage seminars, and both of those kind of tied this same thing, or tied all of this together as well. And so we're going to continue through that this morning. A couple of weeks ago, I read an article in the paper. It was like the front page. I think it was the casino over in Davenport where they were getting ready to set the final beam. Did you guys see that in the paper? And they had all the people had signed it. They were going to put the final beam or the final truss in the roof. I mean, they were completing the foundational structure of this building, I guess you would say, so that now they can go ahead and put the skin on it and make it look the way that it needs to look. And so right at the beginning of the construction, in some ways, they put the final touches on it. You with me there? Yeah. Putting the beginning stuff, or the end stuff at the beginning, yeah. And they all signed it, okay, because it's a big deal. And that's real similar to what God does. Because right at the beginning of the story of God's people and His relationship with His people, in chapter 2 of Genesis, in verse 20, chapter 2, verse 20, that's not where I wanted to go, but I wanted to start reading in the middle of it. It says, but for Adam no suitable helper was found, so the Lord God caused the man to fall into a deep sleep, and while he was sleeping, he took one of the man's ribs and closed up the place with flesh. And then the Lord God made a woman from the rib he had taken out of the man, and he brought her to the man. The man said, this is now bone of my bones, flesh of my flesh. She shall be called woman, for she was taken out of man. For this reason, a man will leave his father and mother and be united to his wife, and they will become one flesh. And the man and his wife were both naked, and they felt no shame. They felt no shame because This was the way things were supposed to be. This was God's intent. This is God's plan from the very beginning. And he sets this, I mean, this is kind of the crowning thing of everything that God is creating in the world. It's the last thing he really makes in some ways, because now all of creation is done, and the next thing God is going to do is rest. And so it's kind of like he's putting that final beam in place by establishing marriage. And that's just pretty awesome to think about it. Right from the very beginning, God establishes marriage. And then you ask, why did he do that so early? Why did he make the church first? And I think the reason for that is because God wanted man to understand from the beginning that man was created to be in relationship. In relationship with God and in relationship with one another. That's the way it is supposed to be. And so from the beginning, one of the first things God does is he makes man aware of this need to have someone with him, this need for relationship. And so in chapter 2, verse 18, the Lord God said, "It is not good for man to be alone. I will make a helper suitable for him." Now God said that before man even realized he needed it. God knew it before man did. Because then, in verse 19, it says, "Now the Lord God had formed out of the ground all the beasts of the field, all the birds of the air, and he brought them to the man to see what he would name them. And whatever the man called each living creature, that was its name." Always wondered where platypus came from. But anyway, moving on. Verse 20. "And so the man gave names to all the livestock, the birds of the air, and all the beasts of the field, but for Adam no suitable helper was found." Adam is watching all of these critters go by, and they've all got mates. They've all got something that helps them, something that fits with them, but not for Adam. And so God caused Adam to fall into a deep sleep, removed that rib, and created, or made, actually, literally, built a woman and brought her to him. Man was created for relationship with God and relationship with man. But in our human relationships, we speak great messages. And I want us to look this morning at what kind of messages our relationships speak, or what kind of messages they should speak. We're going to kind of bounce back and forth on some of these. And hopefully this morning you're going to understand a little more why I am so passionate about this topic. First thing I want you to think about this morning is that human relationships, especially marriage relationships, are the proving grounds for man's relationship with God, or for God's relationship with man. How we treat each other, when we get into relationship, that is a proving ground for God's relationship with us. When I was a kid growing up in kind of southwest Texas, just north of us, kind of between Sonora and Abilene, in a little town called Bront, and just outside of Bront there is the Goodyear testing grounds. Anybody know what they do at the Goodyear testing grounds? They test Goodyear tires. That's exactly right. It's their proving grounds. They design a tire, they build a tire, they want to see how well it works. And so they've got this track, and these guys get out there and they just drive around this track over and over and over and over and over again. It's got hills, and it's got turns, and it's got rough spots, and there's parts where they wet it and all kinds of stuff. They have a hard time building ice, I think. But they do all this other great stuff. And then not only that, living in Sonora, every now and then, if you were out late at night, which of course I never was, but if you were, you might be at the local convenience store, and all of a sudden a line of about 6 or 8 old, beat-up, run-down cars would pull in, and these were tire tester drivers. And all they did was drive all over the country, all over that part of southwest Texas, just kind of nonstop. They would stop for restroom breaks and stuff and put as many miles on these tires as they could. And I always remember thinking that their cars were dirty, they were filthy, they were ratty, their tires looked almost bald, and yet these guys are out driving around the country proving that those tires hold up to the way they're supposed to. Now, well, the interesting thing about all of this is when I got old enough that I'm buying my own cars and buying my own tires, guess which type of tire I tend to gravitate toward? Not Firestone. Goodyear testing ground. Go back and review the earlier part of the sermon, okay? I know some of you may be big Firestone persons, but I saw how many miles they put on those Goodyear tires. And I'm not saying I always buy Goodyears, but I tended to kind of gravitate towards those because I knew they'd been tested, and I knew that they had proved to some point that they were what they claimed to be. Our relationships, especially marriage, is a proving ground for God's relationship with human beings and with others. We claim that God is love. Our relationships prove that claim, or they disprove that claim. We claim that our God is a forgiving God, but our relationships, our marriages, prove or disprove that claim. And so it becomes very important for us to live within relationship in a way that proves that God is what God claims to be. That God is love. That God is forgiveness. God is grace, mercy, and all of these things. It's interesting, when you go to the New Testament and you read passages like 1 Corinthians chapter 13, that wasn't written to be read at marriages. It was written because Paul was reminding the church, you have to live out what you claim God is. And all throughout the New Testament, all these passages about loving your neighbor and loving one another is all within the context of the church. But it also goes over into the context of marriage. In Ephesians chapter 5, Paul says, husbands, love your wives as Christ loved the church. Your relationship is a proving ground for God's relationship with His people. Second thing is that human relationships, especially marriage, help us to understand God's love more fully. Now, I've shared with you a couple of my wife's more interesting points before. And, of course, they're all her interesting points. They're not mine. I've shared with you before how she used to call me every day on her way home from work and ask me, did you feed the cats? Every day she would call. Honey, did you feed the cats? Have you fed the cats yet? As if I'm going to forget to feed the cat. I might on purpose not feed him, but I never forget to feed the cat. And finally I told her, I said, babe, look, I am a 50-year-old man. I've raised kids who have survived into adulthood. I can remember, and you walk into our front door, and the first thing when that door opens, you're attacked by these two. It's like, not like you can forget this, okay? I said, babe, I don't forget to feed the cats. So the next day, she calls me after I explained to her that I don't forget to feed the cats. By the way, they're on automatic feeders now. Anyway, she calls me the next day after we had this long conversation, and she said, so, did the cats eat okay? That was slick, wasn't it? Yeah. Another one. We're driving home every day that we're in the car together, and we pull up to the house, and as we're getting to our driveway, she'll say, honey, stop and get the mail. Honey, stop and get the mail. Honey, stop and get the mail. 14 years of honey, stop and get the mail. And finally, I just can't hardly take it anymore. I said, babe, I know to stop and get the mail. You don't have to remind me every time to stop and get the mail. Well, guess what happens the very first time she doesn't remind me to stop and get the mail? I forget to stop and get the mail. How this woman woman has put up with me for 14 years, I don't know. But when you think about what we put up with in each other in our marriages and how little those kind of things are, and yet think about how patient God is with us. He's not just always having to remind us, you know, hey, don't do this, don't do that. Would you do this? Would you do that? And it's not that, you know, I purposely set out to do things to hurt my wife, but sometimes we purposely do things that we know are going to hurt God. And He's patient with us. And merciful. And forgiving. And loving. And we understand that better when we look at our own relationships and how forgiving we have to be with our spouses. And we realize how forgiving He has to be with us. And so in our marriage, we realize who God is and how awesome He is. We understand His love more fully. Thirdly, human relationships, especially marriage, demonstrate to the world our faith in God. Because when we come up here and we stand in front of a minister and we make these vows before God that we are going to be united by God and we are going to be made into one flesh by God, we are proclaiming that we trust Him to do these things. We are putting our two lives into His hands that He will make the two of us into one. And we are proclaiming to everybody that's sitting in that church building watching us that we believe that God is faithful and that He is going to make that happen. And when we vow to be together until death separates us, we are proclaiming to everybody within the hearing of those vows that we claim to be obedient to God, and we trust that God is going to give us the ability to be obedient and remain faithful to those vows to the very end. So our relationships, especially marriage, demonstrate to the world that we trust, we have faith in God. And the world watches. They watch us as Christians, as we make these vows, as we make these proclamations, as we say these things. And the world learns what we believe based on how we live. Our lives are the loudest sermons we ever preach. And our marriages are often the loudest that we preach. And here is why this is such a passionate thing for me. I was in the fifth grade living in Odessa, Texas. I had one older brother and two younger brothers. And I come home from school one day. Now, Mom and Dad had been having a lot of late-night conversations lately, and I really didn't understand exactly what was going on. But I knew it was something serious because one night, my brother and I were in the den, my older brother and I, we were in the den watching TV. We were the only two in school at that time. And we had a bedtime. And it was before the good shows came on, like Hawaii Five-O. I'm talking the real Hawaii Five-O, not this rerun, remake stuff. But anyway, the good shows. We always had to be in bed before the good shows. But Mom and Dad are out in the living room and they're talking, and they hadn't made us go to bed yet. And I remember, I can see these little clips go through my mind of going out there and asking them, is everything okay? And being told, just go back and watch TV. I knew something was up. A few days later, I come home from school and I walk into a kitchen full of housewives sitting around the kitchen table, smoking cigarettes, drinking coffee, and they're all crying. I didn't know what was going on. I remember my mom getting up and making cinnamon toast for me as an after-school snack in the little toaster oven and then sending me into the den to eat that while she talks with her friends. And I notice as I'm walking from the kitchen into the den that there are suitcases packed in the living room. About an hour later, my grandfather shows up and loads all the suitcases and me and my two younger brothers in the car, and we drive down to the middle school where we pick up my older brother. And we leave my dad. And we move to Lubbock. And I'm told how my dad has been unfaithful, and I'm told how my dad doesn't love my mother, and I'm told you need to call your dad and you need to ask him why he's done these things. I don't remember how long we lived there in Lubbock. I remember it was the most miserable time, almost, of my life as a kid. Watching my parents, who I loved, still loved, treat each other that way and put us kids in the middle of it. By the end of my fifth grade year, sometimes before the school year ended, they got back together and we moved to Sonora, moved out to the ranch, and we started a new school, but it was never the same. There was a fracture that had occurred, and there was a draft that came through that fracture that never went away. You always could sense that there was something still in the air. Held it together for another 8 years, and then when I came home during Thanksgiving break, my freshman year in college, I was informed that the divorce was imminent. Mom and Dad were splitting up. There was no hope left. Now, we weren't real big church-going people growing up. Went to church once, twice, sometimes four times a year. If we went to visit my grandparents in Lubbock, we went more often. And so there were a lot of things I didn't know about faith, but one thing that I had been taught growing up, and I understood this, and I understood it at a pretty deep level, is that when you get up front and you say, I do, and you vow that you're going to be together until death separates you, and you make that proclamation to God, that's serious business. And you're supposed to mean it. And here are these people who had taught me all my life to believe in God and do what's right, and you know, you don't swear, you don't cuss, you don't treat girls a certain way. You know, you do all these things because this is the way God wants you to be. And so they've been taught me all my life that God cares about some of this stuff. And yet, this vow about marriage doesn't mean anything anymore. Doesn't fit what we need now. Now, I don't mean to stand up here and sound bitter and angry at my parents, but there was a lot of bitterness and there was a lot of anger. I'm just telling you right now. Kind of irritates me when people will say, you know, we'll divorce when our kids are young because it won't affect them. It's going to affect them. People will say we're going to wait till the kids are out of the house and divorce because then it won't affect them. I'll tell you, it affects them. Only time that it wouldn't was there was an older couple went to the preacher once and they said, you know, we decided we're going to divorce. He looked at him and he said, Ethel? Fred? You guys have been married 70 years. What? Why divorce now? And they said, well, we wanted to wait till all of our kids were dead. Other than that, I don't think there would ever be a time that it's not going to affect your kids. And not just your kids. Other people that have known you are going to see it because our marriage speaks a very loud message. And it's a message of our faith. Here's why this is so important to me. I think what divorce speaks, what divorce says to the world, is it shows the kids that the parents really don't believe what we teach. I heard yesterday at our marriage conference, there was so much good stuff in that. I mean, if I had taken notes, I had a lot of sermons I could have done. But then I thought for those that were here, that would be kind of a repeat. And I don't want to do that. But there was one thing that I think fits so perfectly. And it was an interview they did with this young couple. And the young couple had gotten to the point where he had gotten so frustrated with his wife. At one point, he had grabbed her by the arms and thrown her onto the bed. And he said in his mind, he justifies it by saying he didn't leave a mark and he didn't actually hit her. He just grabbed her and threw her on the bed. Okay? Ends up, they leave, he leaves, and he goes to his parents' house, and his parents say, you can't stay here unless you're in marriage counseling. So he goes to marriage counseling, and he's talking to the counselor, and the counselor really challenges him about his behavior. Is that Christ-like behavior? And that was pretty powerful. But then the woman starts talking, and she says, you know, here's this guy that she's actually become very comfortable at hating and wanting to leave and everything, and now he's becoming a good guy. And so she decides she's going to go to counseling, go to a couple of sessions just so she can say, hey, I tried it, but it didn't work. But she goes there, and the counselor asks her this question. Says, do you believe that God raised Jesus Christ from the dead? She said, well, I'm a Christian. Of course I believe that. I'm paraphrasing this, so if you watch the tape and I don't get it right, don't sue me. But she says, I'm a Christian. Of course I believe that. He says, if you believe that God is powerful enough to take a dead, decaying body and restore that to life, why do you not believe that God is powerful enough to take your broken, dying marriage and restore that to life? And I think that is so true. And I think that when we as Christians divorce, what we're saying to our kids and to the world around us is we don't really believe that our God raises the dead. We don't really believe our God can heal broken relationships, that He can restore. I think also that divorce shows that we believe obedience is optional and it's secondary to our feelings. Yeah, we sing songs like trust and obey, for there's no other way to be happy in Jesus but to trust and obey. God's Word says, for this reason, a man will leave his father and mother and be united to his wife, and the two will become one flesh. Jesus says, and what God has joined together, let man not separate. To be obedient means to live out those vows till death separates us, irregardless of the feelings that are going along with that. But when we divorce, what we're saying, what our message is that obedience is optional and it's secondary to our feelings. Divorce also, between Christians, shows the world that we are no different than the rest of the world, which makes our claim of being a chosen people, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, a people belonging to God, a lie. You see, if we're no different from everybody else, if we don't view God's way any different than anybody else, then we aren't any. We're not a called out people. We're not separate and apart from anything else. We're just like everybody else. And the reason this bothers me so much, I'm divorced. You guys know that. And I know there are circumstances, and you do too, there are circumstances that are sometimes beyond our control. But the reality is that where we are right now, we have a choice to do what God has called us to or not. And this is what I'm calling us to do, is to live as if we believe this is true. Because guys, if we don't, then we are telling the rest of the world that this is all a lie. And here's why it's important. When I was a kid and when I went through that, I got so just, I didn't believe any of it anymore. None of it's true. Jesus didn't die on the cross. That's just something people tell you as a kid to try to get you to behave and eat your oatmeal. If you don't, I mean, there's starving kids in Africa. And if you don't eat your oatmeal, I mean, if you eat your oatmeal, they won't starve. I don't understand that whole deal. But anyway, and so as a good Christian, you eat your oatmeal so you save all the starving children in Africa. So Bob, did my oatmeal help anybody in your village? I'm just curious. Okay. Just wondered about that. But here's the thing. I went through a lot of long a long period of my life not believing this because of what I had seen in my parents. I had been baptized. I had been kind of a believer. That divorce shattered my belief. And if it hadn't been for a lady that I worked with, sweet little Baptist lady named Terry Barta, who did everything she could to convince me that there is nothing that can separate us from the love of God, if it hadn't been for her, I don't know where I would be today. But what if Terry had never come into my life? What if nobody had ever brought me back into a saving faith? Think of all the people out there in our world today who don't believe this because they've seen the way Christians live their life no different from everybody else. Their divorce rate is just as high. Their infidelity rate is just as high. There are just as many of them that watch pornography. They lie, they cheat, they steal. They're no different from anybody else. Why should we believe what they are teaching? See, your marriage is important. It preaches a sermon. The question is, what are you preaching? Are you preaching that you believe this book and you believe the God who wrote it? Or are you preaching just like everybody else? Next week, we're going to look a little more in depth at the role of the men and the role of the women. I don't know for sure how long each one is going to take, so I can't say we're going to finish it up next week. But I want you to think this week, and I want you to think today about your marriage. Are you doing things to strengthen that marriage and to make that marriage preach the truth of God? Or are you just kind of cruising along just like everybody else, hoping that maybe it hangs out for a few more years and preaching to the rest of the world you don't really believe? Let's pray. Our Father, this is an important topic. We're not about trying to save marriages just because it's a cool thing to do or anything. We're about trying to save marriages because our marriages demonstrate your relationship with your people. Father, you sacrifice so much for your relationship with your people because that is so important to you. Yet we so often just get frustrated and walk away because we don't want to have to sacrifice anymore. Father, help us. Help us to look deeply at our relationships. Not everybody here is in a marriage relationship, but we're speaking specifically to those today. But Father, even relationships within the church, relationships within our family, relationships in other places, Father, we have to live differently than the rest of the world does because we believe in a God who can raise the dead. We believe in a God who can heal broken relationships and restore the dead back to life again, breathe new life, and give a new spirit into things that have already died. Because of that, we trust that you will heal what's been broken in our lives. Father, I know there are some here today that need your help. They need to turn loose of some of these things. They need to put them in your hands. They need prayers. They need forgiveness. They need mercy. They need to show that mercy and compassion and forgiveness. Father, put it in their hearts to do so today. Make it known to them, Father, what they need to do. And we ask all of this in Jesus' name. Amen. Again, as we mentioned this morning, we do have opportunities for you if you need our prayers. Maybe you need to come forward this morning and confess something and ask for prayers, forgiveness. Maybe you need to meet with the elders after services. Maybe you need to fill out a card and put it in an envelope and have one of us get in touch with you during the week. Maybe there's someone here this morning who has never started the kind of relationship with Jesus Christ that you need to. Maybe you've never been united with Him like we talked about last week, where you were buried with Him in the waters of baptism and raised to that new eternal life that He has for you. And if there's anything that we can help you with this morning in any of these regards, please come forward while we stand and sing this song.